All right, everyone. I am here with Asaf Aryeh and Alex Gruyer. Is that right?
Yep, that's right.
Awesome. And they're with Lion Rock Properties, which is focuses mainly on property management and helping investors. So we were talking, and I mean, this kind of started when we were talking about, we think that all realtors should also be investors, but a lot of us are helping investor clients. So can you tell us like a little bit about when we're helping an investor client, what are some of the strategies that they may use when evaluating property? And then we can like dive in.
Right, for sure. So, hi, Asaf here. first of all, before we jump into evaluating the property, we got to understand the investment strategy, right? Mm-hmm. What is the investor looking to achieve? Are they looking for a long-term, short-term? Obviously, the topic here is buy and hold, but even buy and hold come with different strategies, right? Are they looking for example, I bought a condo for my daughter and I don't care about cash flow. I care about her not asking money for college when she's 18, right? So 18 years from now, she's going to have probably a paid off condo, a few hundred thousand dollars of equity, and she can pay her own college, right? Yeah. And I buy it to her when she was born. So that's a strategy. Different strategy is value at refi, cash out after a year or two, right? Or, you know, BRRRR style investing on a single family home, maybe, you know, a couple months, or multifamily, maybe a year and a half, you know, 50 unit rehab, you know, do the whole fun game.
Right.
No cash flow for a year and a half and then cash out, or maybe somebody that's looking to retire, or, you know, retire early, retire late, quit their job and travel the world, and they're looking for a cash flow play, right?
So that's me. That's what I want.
Yeah. There you go.
Margarita font, right?
Yeah, exactly. I've also seen people buy for, they wanted to like have the expenses like for their taxes.
Well, I don't think
I was like, that doesn't make a lot of sense, but
I don't
okay.
Think you can make any investment based on write-offs, right?
Yeah.
but while you make investments, make sure you take advantage of all the write-offs you can.
For sure.
But I don't make that my first priority. It's maybe a fun play on the bottom somewhere. That's, hey, also, by the way, there's write-offs.
Right.
Enjoy. You know, defer income. But I wouldn't make it as my first priority, that's for sure.
Well, I know like one of the strategies that I use, and I think that a lot of agents should also take advantage, is the buy and hold strategy for long-term investment, like longer than a year. I mean, a lot of my stuff I've had for like 10 years. Can you tell us a little bit about how, if we're helping clients with that strategy, how to help them evaluate the properties that they're looking at? Because sometimes they'll be looking at single families or multifamilies, or like maybe they don't know. You know?
Right. So for starters, we love buy and hold for the long term, because everything that we underwrite on a 10-year investment strategy.
Okay.
Doesn't mean we kind of keep it for a 10-year for sure, but I know over a 10-year, we'll go through a full cycle.
Yes.
So if we buy today and it crashes tomorrow, okay, my numbers have changed a little bit. I can move around the spreadsheet, right? It's easy, it's Excel. But on a 10-year, I'm comfortable to say we can meet those numbers. We can go back to those rents. Cap rates will move up and down based on supply, demand, and interest rates. And we'll land somewhere within 10 years in our 10-year scenario, right? So for starters, we love underwriting on a 10-year deal.
What is it? Can you go back and explain what a cap rate is for the people that don't know?
Right. Cap rate is heaven and hell in the same place. Most people don't understand what a cap rate is. And a cap rate is a capitalization rate. And essentially when you evaluate a business, any kind of a business investment, it's the risk you're willing to take on a no debt environment, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in simple words, it's the NOI you require, net operating income. When you have no debt, that's gonna be your cash flow on a certain investment. When there's no debt repayment, when you don't take no depreciation, no amortization, just here's how much I paid, here's how much I'm gonna get every year, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's how much you wanna multiply that in order to get the return you want, right? So it's there's a market cap rate and there's an individual cap rate, right? So if the market is right now at 4.5% cap rate, it's only going to get me after leverage, I don't know, 5.5% cash on cash. It may be below my threshold. And I would say that's too much risk for me to take. I need more cash flow, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the market, you know, drive it at 5.5, 6, 6.5% cap rate, then I may be able to generate 7.5, 8.5% cash on cash. And I say, okay, I can live with that. That's within my cap rate. So there's a market-driven cap rate, and that's the way you underwrite cap rate. But a cap rate is basically the business multiplier.
Right.
And that's how you evaluate businesses too. And if you look at a multifamily and you say, this multifamily is a business, I'm going to let a property manager like these two guys manage the property for me. I don't want to hear about it. I want to see a monthly or quarterly report and get my monthly, quarterly, or annual distributions, right? It's a true cap rate. They look at it as a business. They don't involve it in the day-to-day.
Right.
Buying a stock or a bond, and you get the returns. So that's what.
And you want like a high cap rate.
To get better returns, you want a high cap rate.
Yes.
But the certain market like today, 7% cap rate, you're in a prime neighborhood. So I don't want that, right? Mm-hmm. So you want to, for investors, a higher cap rate is better.
Mm-hmm.
But you want to stay within market. So let's say market is around 5.2%. If I can get a property at 5.5 in a 5.2 place, then there's almost instant profit that I made because I can arbitrage that down, right? Buy it and sell it right away. But those markets are pretty efficient. So you really need to, that's where a good broker that understands investments can help you say, okay, this is priced at 5.2, but we know that it's actually, you can get more rents here, or there's probably a water leakage there. Your NOI.
You can like value proof. Add it to increase the cap rate.
And I'm not even talking about, I'm before value, and I'm just as is. There may be built-in inefficiencies that the current management are suffering from that we can instantly create that arbitrage. That's besides the value at play that we can do.
So if we're an agent and we have a client that wants to either start or add to like their investment portfolio, and they want to look at like single families, multifamilies, maybe a variety of different things, because we're residential agents mostly, right? So we're looking at, what are some of the key things to look at when like initially evaluating the property to be like, yes, we should go further or we should just stop?
You want to take a shot at it?
Yeah. So, well, obviously it depends on the market that we're in and the time.
Yeah.
I can tell you, for now, you want to go into a deal with the goal, and any deal, to close.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, with our clients, we're going into deals where looking more for large scale items rather than the nitpicky little things. Where, maybe back in 2008, 2009, you had the ball in your court to nitpick all the little things, right?
Right.
But now it's, let's get a deal done. So it's coming in with the plan of, all right, there's transparency. Let's be transparent up front from both ends and know that, here you get a deal done. I'm concerned with maybe the mechanicals and the roof, right? The large items. And maybe I know when I see the property, up front, all right, windows may be older. We'll take that into consideration as part of the underwriting process. So really it's have that frame of mind of let's not be too nitpicky, because we know obviously no property is perfect, right? Unless we're building from the ground up, and even those properties,
even those aren't, yeah,
right?
exactly.
So really, it's having the frame of mind of, again, want to come to get a deal done and know what we're going into, and it's known to both parties of we mean business. Looking really for these larger items that may be a concern. I'm not going to come in and say, well, the wall's cracked, from a paint.
Right. But like if a unit, if like half the building needs to be like completely turned over, the units do, or like there's four boilers or that need to be replaced or like something like that, you're saying.
Right. Right. And even with the comment of, hey, maybe half the building needs to be turned over, that could play into still the underwriting from, what we like to do is the value add approach. If all right, they're older units, tenants have maybe been there for 10 plus years, which we have cases of, right? So we know the play is there that, all right, it's probably going to be possibly original carpets, original cabinets, even the appliances, right? But we know that, all right, we're planning to put XYZ per unit with the approach we're going to take.
Yeah. And you can, yeah, you just get like a lot more rent. I remember this one time I bought a building that the tenants were paying like $400. It was like so, a unit, and it, the fair market value at the time was probably about like 950. I was like, this is crazy. And they weren't even bad units. I was like, we should buy this. Cause like the price was like, was pretty low. And I was like, you could instantly like increase these rents, like without doing anything, you know?
That's exactly what I was talking before about the immediate arbitrage. You know that I don't need to do anything.
Yeah.
And rent can go up by, you know, whatever.
Whatever.
In your case, $500.
I know. Awesome. That was great.
$75, you know, something like that, that you know instantly. Just yesterday, we walked across where we moved our scheduled meeting. And just as it is, those units can rent for $150, $200 more. And we plan to do massive innovation and bring it up more, $450 more.
Are you seeing investors have more luck in like single family homes or multifamily or like large multifamily?
Looking backwards, if you invest in single family homes in the last 5 years, you made a killing thanks to COVID-19.
Yeah.
But you know, overall, the entire market is enjoying a tide, not suffering. Enjoying a tide is driven by low interest rates, high demand for one and single family homes. Mm-hmm. For people that actually flip, cities to suburbs. On the other end, you got multifamily that's still delivering decent returns and considered safer than other, assets out there across the country. So, large capitals are moving into multifamily. So everything is enjoying a tide. So you could have been blind and touched something 3-4 years ago and you made a really good return
in
the last 3-4 years. So we're trying to measure ourselves compared to the market. I mean, okay, we've made money for investors. Have we been able to deliver more of the market, at market, or below market? Mm-hmm. That's how we measure ourselves, right? And our goal is obviously to do above market returns.
Yeah, that's a good way, especially because you guys are managing the units and it is their investment. That's how they look at it, right?
Right.
Yeah. So if we're helping, I don't think we answered the original question. So like the go or no go, just basic, like this price and these rents, is there like a formula for that? Like these cost of repairs for this building, where it's like, we'll look more or we won't. What is that?
Yes. You'll have, your purchase price and then your financing strategy. So let's say you're underwriting and it works well. So you got a purchase price, then your financing strategy. Are you looking for a 5% FHA? Are you looking for, no money down, hard money deal? I don't like those. I like, putting that 20% down, 25% work with a commercial local bank that is a partner for your deals. And you don't find on Facebook, hey, I need someone to give me hard money tomorrow because my lender dropped me.
Yeah, don't do that.
So be stable, come strong to a deal. So your purchase price, your down payment, any renovation, try to get your bank to finance that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the local banks will do that. If you somewhat seasoned investor or have a good partner with you, good broker, good managing part, good property management, and then get all your expenses out the door once you get your renovation done. Always recommend to do renovation. So got that out. Some people don't. Some people look for the turnkey. So that element just go off the formula, and then make sure you include all your expenses. Don't forget the dentist expenses, right? The dentist expenses are the predictable unpredictables.
Yes.
Right? When you're sitting today, you don't think about going to the dentist, right? But you know you need to go to the dentist the next 12 months at some point, and they're always going to find something, right?
Right.
So don't ignore them. You'll need a plumber. You'll have a turnover. You'll need an electrician at some point. Maybe not every year, but once every 3 years.
Pest control, eviction,
everything. So forecast in your dentist, your mechanic,
Yes.
All those things that you'll need to handle. So make sure you have some kind of an umbrella. I like to use percentages. It's a you know, 5% repairs, and then, you know, $150, $250 a door per year for capital expenditures. You know, it's on multifamily. If it's a single family home, you know, $400,000 single family home, maybe a little bit more per year in capital expenditures. Don't ignore that. They're not, the fact that you didn't have to go to the dentist in the last 3 years doesn't mean your teeth are good.
Exactly. I think too, I've been budgeting more if it's like really old. Cause there was like one time that I bought a sixth unit that was like 200 years old. Oh my God. It was like when one thing broke, everything broke. It was crazy.
Domino effect, huh?
It was terrible.
And then once you finish, and I'll comment on that here soon as well. And we're dealing with 100-year-old property now. You finish all the expenses, you don't forget your mechanic and your dentist, mm-hmm. and then you go into income. Be reasonable with your rent projections. Yeah. Always be conservative. Give yourself room to do better. Give yourself mm-hmm. room to come to your banker, to your wife, your husband, say, hey, I did better on my investment. And don't keep it too tight that you come and say, can I get an extra $1,000 this month because mm-hmm. I have a vacancy, right?
Right.
Budget in. So be reasonable with your expenses. Put everything in. Like I said, we love percentage raises, mm-hmm. you know, because on multiple transactions, it will win. It will prevail.
Yeah.
In one transaction, you will be off, guaranteed. On multiple transactions, you'll prevail. One right. had a plumber this year, other three units may not need a plumber, right?
Right.
But overall, use a percentage base and evaluate everything as a portfolio. And the income, be reasonable with your income, do good comps, understand the rent drivers, understand if your unit is different, if you don't have a garage, you know, discount that in. You know, mm-hmm. what's the value in the garage in the neighborhood? What's the value of a parking spot? If you right. be able to, let's say it's a single family home, let's say it's a town home, and you can't park in the street, and you can only put two parking spots, you know, on your garage, on your driveway. What does it right. look like? What does it mean compared to other places in the area? Backyard, no backyard, patio, no patio, grills allowed, grills not allowed. Make mm-hmm. sure you put all those things in to see what a reasonable tenant will pay.
Right.
Take the vacancy rate out, you know, if it's 3%, if it's 5%, take it out. And that's your money that you got. You know, take your mortgage payment out, and that's mm-hmm. your fun money.
Not as much as you thought it was going to be.
It's a lot less than what you thought it was going to be.
If we are working with a new investor, what do you think that they should be prepped for to like for me, I always tell them like just owning one rental property is like a pain. Like you need to be prepared to own more. So like, do you guys have that same philosophy and what do you tell them?
You want to go ahead and I'll give a financial view after.
Yeah. So that's the $1 million question.
Right.
I think that the big thing is expect the unexpected for starters, mm-hmm. right? And kind of just how Soph is just going over was really plan for all of the dentist and the mechanic and all of that. It's like you said, you have another job, maybe you come home from your 9 to 5 and you have that property without, right, just say you're self-managing, getting into it if you don't even have a property manager.
Right.
It's a whole other job in itself, right?
Yeah.
Those 2 a.m. my toilet clog headache phone calls, they're no fun, and mm-hmm. they come.
Right? Well, it's always on Christmas too, or like a holiday, or like.
Yep, it's when you had the plan for the birthday party, the surprise party for the your son, your daughter, your friend, and then that call comes in. Right?
Yeah.
So, it's really the expect the unexpected and really plan. I think a lot of people always get in with the thought of, all right, obviously we invest money to make money, right? Mm-hmm. But it's the mindset of not immediately, oh my gosh, what am I going to make every month? What is it going to be? I want to make sure I make the most. Yes, I want to make sure you make the most, but there's multiple avenues of actually making the most, right? It's not necessarily that physical cash to pull every month. It's budgeting correctly for the unexpected. Obviously, you're building equity, it's planned right. And then you have, like you said, the fun money, the excess after, but still
beer money.
Yeah. Beer money. Right. Or the margarita fund, like we said at the beginning, but it's the big, again, expect the unexpected. Plan for those days where the AC is going to freeze over, the coil is going to freeze over, mm-hmm. and I got to get that taken care of. And of course, when does that happen?
90 degrees.
99 degrees.
Yep. Outside,
right.
Always.
Or the heat goes out when it's in Minnesota, -35. Right. So that would be my key thing.
Yeah, what I'm hearing from you guys is like the not budgeting correctly because if you're really not accounting for enough expenses seems to be kind of like the downfall of people that are maybe getting into investment. Is that the main issue?
I'll give you a little bit of my, so I'm an accountant, right? I'm
the what? Major I couldn't guess that. Shocked.
I'm not gonna share my religion here. but I feel like
that's funny. Yes. Okay.
You're probably gonna cut it out. That's not Jewish. The philosophy is this. It's if you're coming in and just trying to get the most cash flow on day one, you are gonna fail. Right. Mm-hmm. It may work for a month, it may work for 6 months, it may work for a year. But when we talk to somebody and we say, you know, we should probably consider updating the kitchen and he cannot come up with $3,000 to save his life. That's a true story. Hopefully you're not going to hear that. Then they're in the wrong business.
Yeah.
Right? They're in the wrong industry. Right. I see people talking about, yeah, you should get for $150 a month. Right. And great cash flow, 10 properties. Then you need to replace water heater in one of them, and that's it. It's done. So counting on it, cash flow is great, right? Here's the philosophy that we built over the last few years, like 10 years, is we started with cash flow. You know, can I cash flow out of it? And we turned into how do we become super wealthy from this property, right? And it took the cash flow pressure off and put the equity value add had on, and now we started to be creative. What can we do? How can we push rents?
Yeah.
How much do I need to reinvest to push those rents? If you bring rent up by $100 a month on a unit, it's $1,200 a year in a multifamily setting, not on single family home setting. If you have time, I can explain you why. In a multifamily setting, a 5% cap, let's say you have some inefficiency on a $1,200 a year extra. Let's say you only have $1,000 a year extra. On a 10% cap, it's $10,000. It's $10,000 return. On a 5%, it's $5,000. No, it's $50,000 return on a $1,000 increase in rents.
Oh, okay. Wow! Yeah.
Oh, sorry, $20,000. It's $20,000 return, 5% cap.
Okay.
Messing up the numbers. So if you bring rents up by $100 for a unit per month, and you calculate like 18%. Inefficiency and say, I get a net $1,000 extra per year on that unit. In a multifamily setting, that $1,000 a year will be equal to $20,000 value add for the property.
Okay.
So where do you get that kind of return? Only in real estate.
Right? Yeah.
That $100 will not going to make me rich.
Yeah. Right?
But at $20,000 times 10 property, that's $200,000. Right. 10 units, that's $200,000. Return.
But why not single families?
Okay, great question. How did you know to ask that question? on a multifamily, multifamily is a business. So you use capitalization rate, the same cap rate that I was grilling you about 10 minutes ago. Mm-hmm. You were grilling me actually about 10 minutes ago. On a single family home, it's not a business, it's a home. Mm-hmm. So you're gonna be valued based on comps. And supply and demand only.
That's true.
Without that cap rate. So whether I'm getting on that unit 1300, 1100, or 1800, it's going to be worth my neighbor's property that sold last week.
Yeah.
Plus minus the adjustments on it. Nobody cares that I'm renting it for, you know, it's a $200,000 unit, but I'm renting it for $3,500 a month, which is a great return.
Yeah.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares. Nobody cares, right? Because
I never thought about that. And I sold all my multifamilies and bought single families.
We met too late.
I think so.
Because the nice thing about a multifamily, from where we're sitting right now, you know, there's a class A property we're sitting right now, and there's a subsidy right behind us, right here, House of Charity.
Yep.
And there's some class C properties right there and some class B right behind it. So you can take a class C, convert it to a class B or somewhere closer to class B. Class C, class B have different cap rates. You move in the cap rate, you make a ton of money, right?
Right.
But a single family home, you cannot
move it. You can't do that. Yeah, I never really like thought about that, but that's very clear. Well, thank you for telling me how much of a mistake I made. Thank you. Well, I appreciate
it. Yeah. What else? Like a
lesson
with your mom growing up.
Oh, geez. Well, what do you have? What are some final thoughts you guys have on, as residential real estate agents, how can we best help our investor clients?
I will take this shot from the financial standpoint, and let Alex talk from relationship standpoint. Mm-hmm. Is push for a portfolio. Even if you buy single family homes, you can make good money on it. You know, when you're taxing a family homes, buy it over time. Mm-hmm. There's a book called A Random Walk in Wall Street. I read it years ago, so I don't know who the author is. But it talks about if you want to eliminate the risk of markets going up and down, buy it over time. Mm-hmm. Right? So if you decide you're going to tax single family homes, don't go and buy 20 units tomorrow. Buy 20 units over the next 4 years, okay. You know, or 5 years, once a quarter. Then if the market goes up, you're enjoying it. If the market goes up, you buy when it's cheaper. You offset, you create an average with what you build high, and your math will work over time. Okay. And you know, real estate is it's a way that you're gonna guarantee to be very wealthy in a long time from now. You know,
yeah.
10 years from now, 15 years from now, 20 years from now, stick to the game, become really wealthy.
Yes.
Not from $100 a month per door.
No.
But from the equity bill, from the mortgage repayment, from the appreciation, from the inflation mm-hmm. protection, from those standpoints, you know, choose a strategy that will work over time, build a portfolio, spread the risk, and then commit to it. And don't try to say, well, it's a really good deal, so I'm going to buy more. And if I had 2 units up until now, so I'm going to buy a fourplex. Spread it over time and spread the risk. And that way you don't need to time the market. Then you can buy when you think the market is super hot.
Yep.
4 years ago, people thought the market is super hot. Look where it is today.
Right. Yeah.
So if you're going to know you're going to invest over time, come in over time.
Yeah.
That's what your recommendation.
It's a long-term play.
It is. And it will guarantee to make you super wealthy if you know how to build that plan.
Up. Well, I mean, in America, most of the wealth was built. It has a pretty strong, most of the wealthy people have really strong real estate portfolios, right? I mean, that's how people build wealth. And I think that was true back then and it's still true today, right? Do you agree?
It is.
100%. Yeah.
With the right strategy. Some people, we've seen people losing money on deals.
Yeah.
Like literally, it's sold in the last couple of years and they lost money on it because they didn't buy right. They thought they're buying cash flow. They went into bad neighborhoods, zero appreciation, bad tenants, evictions, moratoriums. Mm-hmm. And it just creates bad situations.
Yeah.
Come in smart, use, you know, smart people like us in the Minneapolis good area or similar to us in other neighborhoods and regions and really have a strategy to play.
Yeah, I like it. Alex, what's your advice?
From a relationship standpoint, I mean, so rely on, you know, the property managers to help, you know, kind of paint that picture or help plan that goal that we initially talked about with the strategizing of where we want to be, what the goal is, you know, 10 years, 5 years, whatever mm-hmm. it may be for the client. You know, I always discuss, so I started at Coldwell Bank years mm-hmm. ago, and I will forever be grateful for that, right? For the experience, because I was getting my feet wet. Obviously started as a everyday realtor license before my broker's
right.
license. And I can tell you now, fast forward, 10 years now, are we? I now get referrals from past realtors that I worked with in that office and mm-hmm. around the metro now, because they know that we're the property management guys, right?
Yeah.
They know that we can help bring in that plan when it comes to, you know, analyzing the property that they're looking to help the client on. And my big thing is, we are here to help. I know some realtors think, oh, I bring another realtor, they're gonna wanna get paid. We're not here to step on toes. We're here to be another tool in the utility belt
right.
to help your client, you know, analyze the property that they wanna have you help them purchase or portfolio, whatever it may be. But really lean on the relationship there to be that, again, to be that tool from the people that we experience it from managing third party for others, as well as owning our own. Believe me, we know all the pros and cons, and there's a lot of headaches that come that people don't expect to come, but we can weigh in.
We should do a whole nother video of all the stories and all the crazy stuff, you know?
We're going to have a lot more than a half an hour.
I know. So if people have a referral for you, do you only do Minneapolis, St. Paul, yes, for property management?
We do the Minneapolis, St. Paul greater area. So locally here, it's the kind of the 694, 494 loop.
Okay.
It's pretty much 75% of people in Minnesota live in that loop.
Okay.
We don't manage a field of corn.
You don't manage the cows as tenants and
We don't do cow management. Yeah. but we do the greater Minneapolis central grid area, so the suburbs, the center suburbs, and all that. They can shoot us an email. They can shoot us directly at alex@lrprop.com or Saf if they dare to try to spell my name correctly.
I'll put it in the notes and on the YouTube channel.
And they can give us a call too.
Yeah, right to our office, 952-303-5982, right in St. Louis Park. But
great. I just want to kind of figure out on Alex's comment. If you're a realtor and you want to be known as somebody that helps investors, make sure you take investors that close. Alex touched it a little bit at the beginning. You want to have, as an agent, you want to have the name of an agent that when he put an offer for the client, that's going to go through.
Yeah.
Don't think about, understand the market. This market now, you cannot remarket and renegotiate a deal.
Yeah.
I mean, you can, but you'll be looked at funny. This is a seller's market coming to close. Obviously, if something big comes up, retrade
that's
the deal.
That's different, right.
Right, but don't come in and say, we have some paint chipping and light fixtures and the carpet is old.
Right. Don't. No. You saw all that.
Yes. Yeah. 2012, you could have. 2013, maybe 15, but it changed. It's a seller's market. Mm-hmm. Go in with the intent to close. If you think your client will not close, don't represent them, because if they give you a bad name, you get a bad name, you don't get the deals before everybody else gets the deals.
Right.
So basically, three layers of the deals, how the deal flow kind of big is you get the really close friends that get the deal first, mm-hmm. and then you get the email blast, and then you get the graveyard and loop net that the deals go to die, right? So if you're a broker, an agent that closes for his investors, you'll get the first look at it. Mm-hmm. When you bid on it, you don't need to have highest and best and bid with 15 other people.
Right.
Be an agent, from an agent standpoint, close. If you don't think your client will close, don't follow that $10,000 commission, because it may take literally hundreds of thousands of dollars of commissions down the line, because you don't have access to those deals.
Right.
Don't be greedy. Do not be greedy out there. And you do very well.
Exactly.
That would be a kind of a summary point from an agent standpoint.
Awesome. Well, I really appreciate you guys being on. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
It's been a pleasure.
Absolute pleasure.